First of all, I would like to say good morning and good afternoon and good evening to the participants, because we have participants from America, from Europe, and also from Asia. So hello to everybody, and I'm starting this presentation on performance guarantees. This presentation is broadly divided into two sections. In the first section, we're going to share the concept of performance guarantee, and where we're going to be sharing the who all are the players, what benefits are received by the contracting party, the risk assumed by the guarantor, and then we will speak about the implicit parent support, how actually that fits in performance guarantee situations. And then the second part of the presentation will be taken up by my colleague John Hollis, where he will be speaking about the transfer pricing methodologies, which are important when we evaluate performance guarantee situations, and also which all methodologies are not appropriate when we deal with performance guarantees, and situations where can we say that there should not be any charge of performance guarantee fee. So with that background, I start with my presentation. So I'll go to my first slide, where I will share what performance guarantee is, and I'll give you a bit of background around performance guarantee. Now, as we know that performance guarantee is a new area of concern, not only for taxpayers, but also for the tax authorities. It has been evolving much more for the last 4 to 5 years, and we do not have much literature in international tax or from the OECD, where we can say that yes, they define or they discuss performance guarantee explicitly. When we say performance guarantee, it is basically an assurance to customers of a certain standard of contract performance. So the underline in performance guarantee is that we are looking at those situations where a service provider has to follow the terms and conditions as per the contract and provide services. Those services could be construction of a building, construction of a plant, and there would be certain activities where a company is entering into putting up a bid for a project. There also performance guarantee will come in play. Few examples of performance guarantee would be like bid bonds, construction bonds where construction has to happen, custom bonds where custom authorities, they expect performance guarantee possibly from a bank which is backed up by a parent, that if the customers of the subsidiary, they don't pay custom duties, then the custom authorities, they expect to get duties from the bank. And then there are other examples like collision guarantees, where a ship is going from one place to another. If collision happens, the relevant authorities, they expect a collision guarantee from a parent or a bank. We have to keep in mind that when we speak about performance guarantee, we are talking about the contractual obligations, which are primarily long-term in nature. And I would rather feel that when we speak about performance guarantees, it's more about where a lot of functionalities involved, a party has to fulfill a lot of activities, and then it becomes important that it adheres to the terms and conditions to the contract. So generally, there are specific performance metrics which are defined and agreed in advance between the service provider and the customer, so that if service provider doesn't match up with those performance metrics, then a guarantor would come in play and possibly complete that project or pay the penalties. It is always advisable that there should be few qualifications in the contract between a guarantor and the guaranteed party, which is a customer, because no guarantor would like that, if there's any damage, then he's either taking more risk or no customer would like that. He's not receiving money from the guarantor in time. Another important point in performance guarantee is that an event has to happen before any liability arises. And once the event happens, then there will be a question of penalties or possibly that a guarantor makes sure that the project is complete in time. And it is not that, you know, customer would always go to the guarantor. Customer has an option, has also multiple remedies available where he can even talk to the service provider and make sure that he completes the job before he goes to the guarantor. Now, we have seen a lot on financial guarantees in the literature and also in the marketplace, but performance guarantee tremendously differs from financial guarantees in the sense that the underlying obligation in performance guarantee is to complete the project or to complete the activity. That is the underlying obligation. However, if you look at in totality, even in performance guarantee, the financial aspect is involved. For example, when we speak about surety bonds, which provide some kind of guarantee, there also a surety looks for a financial position of the company which is seeking to be bonded. So ultimately, although we are saying that underlying obligation is to complete the project, but in totality, you know, it's ultimately we are talking about the financial aspects. Now, we have been seeing performance guarantees in traditional industries like shipping, construction, engineering, defense, government. But because of globalization, we are also seeing new industries like information technology, media, renewable power generations. These are the new industries where we are seeing more performance guarantee situations are coming up, and more so in emerging markets where the government is pushing to develop infrastructure, and there, because of the duration of the projects, which are long term in nature, and also they are capital intensive, there are a lot of expectation from the government that service provider should get a guarantee support either from a bank or possibly from a parent. We'll go to the next slide, slide number 2. There are 3 players which are very crucial to any performance guarantee arrangement. One is the guarantor who provides the guarantee. He can provide guarantee directly or he can provide guarantee through a bank. Example would be which I just shared in my first slide. If customs authorities are expecting customs bond, so that the customers of the subsidiary, they pay custom duties. In that case, customs authorities will get custom bonds from a bank, but the bank will have a back-to-back guarantee arrangement with a parent of the sub. And second party, which is crucial to this, is a contracting party, which is a subsidiary, for example, of a parent, where it gets a guarantee support from the parent. And the third party is basically a customer or a guaranteed party, which is basically the beneficiary of this guarantee arrangement. And the transfer pricing come in play when we have guarantor and contracting party. They are sitting in 2 different jurisdictions, and then we have to deal with arm's length principle. We also have to keep in mind that the intercompany agreement, it's not only the intercompany agreement, but also the guarantee fee should be at arm's length. And the intercompany agreement for a guarantee fee should mirror the agreements between the contracting party and the customer or the guaranteed party, and the agreement between the guarantor and the guaranteed party that it will support if there's any failure in the performance of the activity. We'll go to next slide. Now, in this slide, I will be, you know, speaking about some key considerations around performance guarantee situations. We have generally seen that, you know, there is an industry requirement where if a party has to bid a contract, then a guarantee is invariably required, and which makes a party to eligible to bid. And also in those industries where the stakes are very heavy, for example, supply of electricity to consumers, so where the government electricity distribution authorities, they expect a guarantee that the service provider should supply electricity at the agreed capacity so that consumer should not suffer. And also where, for example, if a ship is going from one country to another, then also there are collisions, bonds or guarantees are expected by a specific industry like shipping. So generally, you know, there has been a tendency that because of the industry requirements, they expect a party to have a guarantee backup either from a bank or from a parent. Now, next question we have to, you know, ponder is that whether a contracting party have a sufficient credit worthiness to obtain a standalone performance guarantee. Now, if we compare a situation where a contracting party doesn't have any credit worthiness and we cannot find any other comparable in the marketplace because our contracting party doesn't have any credit worthiness, then one can possibly say that any support from a parent could be classified as equity. However, not having the comparables in the marketplace doesn't mean that there is no guarantee support coming from the parent. So therefore, if there are situations where the credit worthiness of a contracting party is low, in that case, possibly, you know, if a parent is providing a guarantee, then we can discuss and evaluate that whether there should be a profit split should be shared by the parent.
Virender, I have a question from one of the attendees. He asks, in a performance guarantee, should the guarantor only be responsible to pay the money when there is a claim, or should the guarantor also be responsible for delivery, implementation of the project?
Yeah. It's a relevant question because, you know, there can be different performance guarantee arrangements. So there could be some arrangements where two parties agree that I'm happy with receiving the penalty or the financial charges. And there could be a second situation where not only the party expects a penalty or some kind of charge, but he will also expect a guarantor to complete the project. So it depends, it varies from case to case. And there are also situations where if a guarantor has to pay a penalty charge or complete the project, guarantor also looks for some recovery from the contracting party who was supposed to, at the first instance, was supposed to deliver the project in time.
Okay.
I hope this answers your question. I'll go to next point on this slide. Now, these performance guarantees are important, but it is also important to see that whether a contracting party is receiving economic benefits when it comes to two related parties having this performance guarantee arrangement. Generally, we see benefits in this performance guarantee arrangements are in the form of where a party is able to bid for a project or a contract. It also gets a better contract terms because there's a guarantee support from the back. And at times, if there's no guarantee support in place, there could be some restrictive covenants in the agreement between a service provider and the customer. So when there's a guarantee support, one can also have some relaxed covenants so that the service provider, or in our example, a subsidiary, has a lot of flexibility to perform its job, and it can also look for new contracts because it's not so much bound by a specific restrictive covenants because there was no guarantee in place at the first instance. And also where if a subsidiary is a newly organized affiliate, there also a parent comes and support and provides a guarantee because no third party would provide a contract to a party where it doesn't have any backup or any experience. But then there will be a question here whether a parent is benefiting as a shareholder or a sub or subsidiaries benefiting because, you know, it is able to get a contract. But I feel that even in these situations, there should be a charge, a guarantee fee, which a sub should be paying to the parent. I'll go to the next slide. Now, one of the critical elements in performance guarantee is that what type of risk are assumed by the guarantor and can we really quantify them? So, one of the primary risk of a guarantor is that if the contracting party or in our example, if a subsidiary will fail, then there will be a kind of a penalty charges or non-fulfillment of completing the project. That risk will come on to the guarantor and he has to pay the money, the penalty, and also in some cases the guarantor has to also ensure that the project is completed. Either guarantor does himself or he gets another party to do the job. So that's a very important risk for a guarantor. And there's another element to the risk where even a guarantor can default, where even a contracting party can default in making payments to the guarantor in the form of a guarantee fee. Because if a contracting party doesn't have enough creditworthiness, it may not be able to pay a guarantee fee to the guarantor. And also, as I shared in my earlier example, a guarantor can also look for some recovery from the contracting party or the subsidiary. But there also, if guarantor is unable to do that recovery, it runs a risk of losing that money. Now, the objective of a guarantor is to ensure that, you know, there are you know, minimal claims, because there are other parties which are attached to the project, and there could be other lenders also. So the objective of a guarantor is not that, you know, there could be a default and for that it's getting a guarantee fee. The objective of a guarantor is that to ensure there is a less possibility that a contracting party will default on the contract. And even this risk of a guarantor can be quantified. There are different methodologies like Monte Carlo simulation model, where we can have a probability of occurrence of specific loss which will happen if a contracting party is unable to perform as per the contract. And then it gives you a kind of confidence level where you can say that with, say, 5% or with 95% confidence, how much loss going to be, with 99% confidence, how much loss going to be. So there are methods available. I'll go to next slide, which is on whether there could be a consideration on implicit parental support. We have been seeing a lot of debates in this specific area. We have already seen cases like General Electric Capital case in Canada, where the implicit support was recognized by the court. And however, if you look at the existing literature, primarily from the OECD, it clearly defines between passive versus active association. And it clearly says that for any implicit support, a related party should not pay a guarantee fee because there is a specific arrangement in place and no benefit is being received by the subsidiary and no services are provided by the parent. So, you know, it's a highly debatable topic, and before I share my perspective, I will share two school of thoughts. One is which is in against of charging for implicit support, and second which is in favor of charging for implicit support. So the line of thought which says that we should not charge for the implicit support is that the OECD encourages a separate entity approach, and the starting point of arm's length principle is that we should disregard the related party relationship. And also, if we do not disregard the related party relationship, then it will be a kind of a free rider situation where if a subsidiary is getting benefited because of implicit support, One can argue that a subsidiary should pay even a parent for, you know, having that implicit support, passive support. And I would like to draw a very clear distinction between implicit support in case of loan arrangements and implicit support in case of guarantee arrangements. When we have guarantee arrangements, whenever any guarantee happens, there is a tendency or a behavioral change in the party which is providing guarantee, because if a parent is looking for a guarantee for a sub, that means there is inherent risk in the whole arrangement and parent may not come and rescue the subsidiary. So the implicit support argument actually weakens when we have a performance guarantee situation. Now there are arguments in favor of charging for implicit support, which says that we have to compare the situation between two related parties with a situation which is available in the marketplace. So if market recognizes that there is always a parent support whenever any defaults happens, then one should expect that there should be a charge for implicit support. For example, the credit rating agencies, you know, they actually factor when they do a credit rating any implicit support from a parent, because parent will always be there to support the subsidiary in various cases. And also, if there's a lot of control which is coming from the parent on subsidiary, one can also argue that the functions, or for example, a treasury function of the sub, are kind of driven by or controlled by the parent, and there is obviously there should be a charge for the implicit support. But my judgment is that as I said earlier, in guarantee arrangements, you know, if a parent is looking for a guarantee for a sub, then there is already an inherent risk in the whole arrangement, and a guarantor would have a much larger risk than what we see in other loan arrangements. So in these situations where we have got guarantee, performance guarantee situations, there would be a likelihood that we would not have any fee for any implicit support from a parent. And also implicit support, you know, it loses its power, especially because, as I said earlier, you know, there are arrangements happening and there would be a likelihood that a subsidiary will fail and parent may allow the subsidiary to fail, and hence there should not be any guarantee fee on any implicit support from the parent. So with that, I complete my presentation. I hand over this to my colleague John Hollis.
All right. Thank you very much, Virender. I'd like to give a little introduction to John, but before I do, I would like to remind all of our attendees that today's presentation will be available on the TPA website within the next 48 hours, so if you would like to visit the site and download in any of the materials that you have heard here today, that will be available to you. Also, if you would like to ask a question during today's presentation, you may do so by going to the top of your screen and finding the chat icon, clicking on that, and directing your question to the two presenters today. Our next speaker today is John Hollis. John Hollis is a co-founder and managing director of Cuffed Analytics, a transfer pricing consulting firm headquartered in Calgary, Canada. He has over 12 years of experience in assisting numerous multinational companies, including some of North America's largest energy companies, with analyzing, designing, documenting, and defending their transfer pricing policies and procedures for all types of intercompany transactions, including intercompany financial transactions. In addition to his transfer pricing experience, he has over 17 years of corporate banking and corporate finance experience, which involved credit risk assessment and negotiating pricing for all types of financial transactions while working in senior positions with major Canadian financial institutions. He now uses this banking experience to assist his clients in determining the arm's length charges for intercompany loans, financial guarantees, performance-related guarantees, factoring, leasing, and derivatives. Through his previous role in credit risk management for a major Canadian bank, which provided production-based loans to junior and intermediate oil and gas firms, he has a strong understanding of the functions, related risks, and intangibles of the oil and gas industry. John, are you there?
Yes, I am, Guy. Thank you.
There you go.
Hello, everyone. I just wanted to, before I start the part of my presentation, Brenda's comments on implicit parental support, I want to mention that just co-authored a BNA article on that topic, and if anybody's interested in that and doesn't have access to the article directly through your subscription, I can arrange to send you a copy of that article. Before I get into the overview of the methodologies for determining arm's length guarantee fees for performance guarantees, I want to start talking about the no guarantee fee situation, because that comes up from time to time. In essence, the arm's length performance guarantee fee is some intersection between the price of the risk assumed by the guarantor and the benefits received by the contracting party, that's the related party, the sub, relative to the performance guarantee that is being provided to the guaranteed party. All of this, which Farinder has commented on as well. So that that third party, the guaranteed party, has entered into a commercial contract with the contracting party. So there'll be obviously some benefits to the contracting party as a result. There can also be some benefits to the guarantor, some collateral benefits that are derived from the commercial contract with the contracting party and the guarantee party. So that's kind of the framework. So if we look at the no guarantee fee cases, we have to look at whether or not the guarantee, the performance guarantee that is being issued doesn't provide any economic benefits to the contracting party. Now, does that ever happen? It's not likely. There's going to be some economic benefits. Is there any situation in which the guarantor is not assuming any risks? Sometimes that can happen. And to illustrate that, I want to talk about a project that I was involved in a couple of years ago. And I have to talk to in general terms, of course. In that project, the guarantor was the parent of the sub, and the sub entered into a sale agreement with a third party. The sale price on that agreement was contingent upon an external event not occurring. If this event did occur, then the sale price was adjusted, and there was some time period involved for this event not occurring. The guarantor provided the guarantee, but the guarantor also received all of the sale proceeds. So in effect, it not only received but controlled all of the sale proceeds to cover its exposure under the guarantee. So in this case, there was no or zero credit risk to the guarantor. And also in our analysis, the sub, the party that had sold the assets, wasn't receiving any additional benefits other than maximizing the sale price, wasn't receiving any additional benefits under the guarantee. So in that particular case, the risk was mitigated entirely by control of the cash. It was kind of cash collateralized performance guarantee, and as a result, there was no guarantee fee charged. That particular case, that was a few years ago, that particular case is under audit right now, and so far the tax authority has been accepting that argument. It has not finalized, so I don't want to give the impression that it's finished, but so far the tax authority is fine with that argument. So essentially, for no guarantee fee to exist, or in a case where a nominal guarantee fee might be applied, is really that twofold test. The risk to the guarantor has to be low, or for no guarantee, it has to be fully mitigated, or there's little or no benefit to the contracting party. And again, that's a very rare situation. Or the guarantor is receiving some collateral benefits from the commercial contract. And by that I mean the contract that the sub has, the commercial contract, may involve the guarantor providing some other services or goods. And if the sub did not enter into that contract, the guarantor as a supplier of the goods and services would not generate profit. So those are the types of collateral benefits that I'm referring to. Could you go to the next slide, Ed? Some methodologies that are used in certain circumstances for determining guarantees for financial type guarantees would not be the most appropriate methodologies for analyzing performance guarantees. I'm not going to get into a big description of these methodologies, but briefly, the yield spread analysis looks at the difference in bond yields for different credit ratings. And essentially, this methodology suggests that bond yields would be higher if the issuer of the bonds was at a lower rating. This is not relevant to a performance-related guarantee, and as Verinder has already stated earlier, the performance guarantee is really being viewed as being less risky than a direct credit exposure, and a bond is a direct credit exposure. And to that point, what we've seen with financial institutions in particular is that under the regulatory environment from the Bank for International Settlements and Basel II in particular, there's a risk weighting that goes with direct credit exposures and versus ones that are more contingent, performance-related specifically. And depending on financial institutions' interpretation of that, it could be anywhere from a 50 or two-thirds type of risk weighting. So as a result, they have less economic, or in this particular case, more precisely, regulatory capital assigned to those exposures that they have under performance guarantees, and therefore that reflects in the pricing. The interest rate savings approach is similar to the yield spread approach in that, except that it's really based on transactional data. It's calculated, and then there's a difference or determination of the split of the interest rate savings that the borrower obtains on a guaranteed loan compared to what it would obtain theoretically on an unguaranteed loan. Again, this is interest rate savings, not relevant for performance guarantee for much of the same reasons as yield spread analysis is not, because that's dealing with, again, a direct credit exposure and not with a contingent liability like performance guarantees. The option pricing models, they're based on finance theory, really trying to determine the price of a guarantee using the model. It's really pricing a financial guarantee related to a loan in that the guarantor is assumed to have a contingent claim on the assets of the borrower in the event of default. In addition, this model relies on inputs that are not easily determined and sometimes difficult to defend in front of a tax authority. So really, it's not applicable and it's difficult to use, I guess is what I'm saying there. So if these methodologies don't work very well for us in analyzing performance guarantees, what does work? And if we can go to the next slide, I can talk to that. So one of the first things to consider methodology is to look for cuts that we could use to apply the CUP method. CUP Analytics does have a proprietary database of third-party credit agreements. These are credit agreements with standby letter credit facilities that are filed with the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission. While not all companies that have filed credit agreements with the SEC are rated companies, we also have in that database information from S&P, which is their S&P credit scores. In particular, the most recent credit score of each of those companies prior to the execution date of its credit agreement that's filed with the SEC. So we in fact have implied credit ratings for these companies along with the actual agreements, credit agreements themselves. So typically when we want to use the CUT approach, so comparable uncontrolled standby letters of credit that are issued by banks on behalf of companies with comparable credit risk to the tested party, those are the CUTs, we would be doing a search. We try to stay within the broad industry group. There are differences in pricing sometimes. There's differences in pricing between industry groups by financial institutions, by the banks. To conduct the survey, of course, we have to have an estimate of the credit risk of the party, of the contracting party. You can use all kinds of credit risk models, such as S&P's credit model, or some other reliable methodology that would determine the credit risk of the party. As Brenda was last talking about implicit parental support, you'd have to at least consider whether or not that exists and whether or not it would have any impact on the standalone implied credit rating from that credit risk analysis. Then once you have that, then you do a search for these cuts. Typically, you'd have to go back probably 12 months from the execution date of the control transaction to ensure that you have enough data to work with. Again, not all companies that file credit agreements have performance-related letter of credit facilities. They could have financial-related letter of credit facilities, but not necessarily performance-related. Typically, that search may produce 5 or 10 cuts. If I can go to the next slide, I'll talk about another methodology. So there's going to be circumstances where we're not going to find any or there's going to be an insufficient number of cuts to apply the cut method. So we're looking at the profit split method. One of the reasons we typically do not find enough or any cuts is that the implied credit rating of the contracting party, the company, is of a relatively low credit worthiness. And as a result, there's going to be little or no publicly available data. The banks generally do not set up performance-related letter of credit facilities for low credit quality companies.
Now, John?
Yes. Sorry.
We have a question from one of the attendees. It's from Rob Reinvost. And his question is this. Implicit support by the parent could be enhanced in the interest percentage of a loan from parent to subsidiary by asking a higher or lower interest rate. In which way do you recognize these different rates, and if there are also performance guarantees, how do you estimate the arm's length range?
That's a very, very detailed question. Maybe I can just answer that in a more general way, and that the implicit parental support would have an impact on the implied credit rating or credit risk of the party. So that then translates into, in a particular example I was giving for the other methodology, using cuts to apply the cut method, would mean that you'd be searching for cuts executed by companies that have a higher rating. So that would imply that you would be finding transactions were either loans, the lending margin on loans, or the guarantee fees on performance guarantees would be lower as a result of that impact of implicit parental support. Well, there's the two, and again, it gets a little bit off topic here, but the implicit parental support analysis is you have to look and see whether or not it actually exists, and then you have to quantify it. So that's a whole different presentation. And again, maybe Rob, the best thing to do is to look at that article that I co-authored on implicit parental support. That might help. And if not, certainly can answer more direct question on it.
And John, just I want to add here that, you know, this problem of implicit support and taking it out, it's become all the more difficult if, you know, somebody is trying to use interest saving approach where we look at how much group company will pay with guarantee and without guarantee. But so they will obviously, what we get from there may not be appropriate to find a right performance guarantee fee. But yes, you know, the other approaches which you are discussing, a cup approach where we are looking at standby letter of credit, one can still decisively look for calculating the performance guarantee fee.
Oh, most definitely. Again, the analysis for implicit parental support is around the credit risk of the party. So if you're looking at standalone implied credit rating for the party, you then consider whether or not you would notch that up as a result of implicit parental support. If the analysis says implicit support wouldn't exist, and again, implicit support exists only from the perception of the other party, the counterparty. So if the market, debt markets for loan or in this case, in terms of issuing a guarantee, if that party would consider that the creditworthiness of the party that the credit risk is being taken on is enhanced by just being part of the larger group, then you come to the conclusion that it would exist, but you still have to determine whether or not it would have any impact on the pricing. And it's not an easy topic. It's not one that unfortunately we could fully address within this presentation. Maybe we need to do a webinar on that. If that's sufficient, if I could continue.
Certainly.
Okay, thank you. If we're using a profit split method for determining the arm's length guarantee fee for performance-related guarantee, it's similar to any other profit split analysis. We have to consider the entire profit that's earned by the commercial contract that the guarantee is enabling. And it assumes, of course, that without the guarantee, the guaranteed party of the sub would not get that contract, and of course wouldn't potentially earn any profits from the commercial contract. Then we're doing a full contribution analysis is required to determine the relative contributions made by the party, the guarantor in particular, to assess the impact of the profit of the commercial contract and how much of that potential profit would be paid to the guarantor for its contribution. And this amount can then easily be translated into or converted into a guarantee for fee percentage. We do see some situations where the projected commercial profit from the commercial contract is not that large in terms of the magnitude of it. And one of the things we need to do is really try to quantify the return that the guarantor would require for the risk that they're assuming, and then look at that profit split analysis with respect to the actual price of the guarantor's risk. And if I can move to the next slide, I can talk a little bit more about that, because that's our other methodology. So we can use finance theory to determine what the return would be to the guarantor for the risk that it's assuming. This methodology is again very, very specific to each project, and again it probably would take a whole presentation to go into it in depth. So I'm just going to cover off some important points with respect to determining the return on credit risk methodology. And Vrinda's talked about this as well, but sometimes we don't know what the amount of the exposure is going to be to the guarantor under that guarantee arrangement in providing the performance guarantee. The exposure is not known until the contracting party actually fails to perform under the contract. In these cases, then, we're using the Monte Carlo simulation to calculate the expected value of the performance default event. And that is important because we need to know what that value is in order to apply the guarantee fee percentage to that amount to determine what the actual guarantee fee would be. Next, we look at the concept of expected loss. And in order to do that, we need to estimate the probability of default of the contracting party after the performance default has occurred. And that, of course, is the contracting party would not have the financial resources to reimburse the guarantor for its exposure or payments that is made under the performance guarantee. Again, there's models for estimating probability of default of the borrower. There's Moody's risk calc model that can estimate the expected default frequency of the EDF, which is the same thing, essentially equivalent to a probability of default. There's also publicly available data on probability of default by credit rating category. So the other part to calculate expected loss is that we need to know what would be the recovery or estimated recovery in the event of default by the contracting party. This is called loss given default or LGD. That data is a little harder to come by, but typically a reasonable assumption would have to be made in terms of what the LGD would be. Essentially, if the higher the PD, probability of default, or LGD, loss given default, the higher the expected loss. Expected loss is one of those components of the return on credit risk. The other component is unexpected loss. So the guarantor needs to earn a return on its economic capital at risk. And again, that's the expected loss component, the volatility of expected loss. If we can find historical data on the probability of default and over a sufficient period of time, and we have good data or good assumptions on LGD, then we can apply a formula. There's a finance theory formula for calculating or estimating unexpected loss. So the return of
John?
Sure.
Yes, John, we have about 5 minutes left. I just wanted to remind you.
Okay. So the return to the guarantor for the credit risk would be the sum of those two components. So I'll just move on to two examples. So I can go to the next slide. So again, Brenda touched on a few of these, so I may be able to move through these rather quickly, but these are general examples that specifically come from projects that I've worked on. In the particular example one is the example where the bank is actually issuing the guarantee. So the parent has a credit facility with performance letter of credit facility within that, and it issues the bank issues it on behalf of the parent. It's really for the benefit of the sub, of the contracting party, because it's a letter of credit issued to support the commercial contract that the contracting party has. So the bank is charged a fee to the parent, but that guarantee fee is based on the parent's creditworthiness, its credit rating or whatever credit risk analysis is done. So what should be the parent charge to the subsidiary? There is obviously an indemnity or some sort of intercompany agreement between the parent, the guarantor, and the contracting party, the sub. Typically, we have been able to just use the cuts applying the cut method. So we're benchmarking the arm's length standby letter credit fee for performance guarantees. And that is based on the contracting party's credit or implied credit rating. So really, in essence, what that does is gives us a benchmarking of the two components. That is, the bank's fee that is charging to the parent plus some other fee for the use of the parent's letter of credit facility. And the combination of those two things is the benchmarked arm's length letter of credit fee. If I can move to the second example, I can move through that in a couple of minutes as well. Sorry, the next slide. Go back one, please. So this is the second example, which is the really issuing a corporate guarantee. There's no bank involved. The guaranteed party is satisfied with just having the corporate guarantee of the parent. And again, we've been very successful in just benchmarking that. However, sometimes there are collateral benefits to the guarantor that would result in a downward adjustment to the benchmarked letter of credit fee. Typically, this scenario is the one that comes into play with the profit split method. Sometimes we have to apply the profit split method to corporate guarantees, relatively speaking, more frequently than we do to the other example where the bank letter of credit is issued on behalf of the parent for the benefit of the contracting party. I've gone through that very quickly, but I just want to finish with sort of identification of these types of guarantees, the performance guarantee transactions. In this example here, where the parent issues the guarantee, the typical way that we have identified these is through either legal department, which has control over the issue of legal agreements, which this corporate guarantee would be, or through the heads of the applicable or relevant business units that would typically issue performance-related guarantees. The other example one, we find that those are easily identified through the Treasury Department, which tracks all of the letters of credits that are issued because they impact on the amount of available credit. Its Treasury Department doesn't have the list. Certainly the bank that's administering the credit facility will record and track those LCs issued. And with that, I conclude my part of the presentation. Any other questions?
Yes, we do have a couple of questions for you, John.
There is one question where the question is that why a customer, why can't a customer have a contract with a guarantor directly, or having a service contract directly with a guarantor? Why customer for a contract with a subsidiary? And the answer to this question is that. While we need to see how the business actually works. Now, if we see that all these performance guarantee, you know, contracts which are between parent and the subsidiary, they are for the commercial contract which is between a sub and a customer. Now, these contracts happen in specific jurisdiction. So, how the business works is that, you know, they will have a different corporate identity. So, subsidiary will have its own legal identity, and in all likelihood, the MNC group would want that the subsidiary should have a contract with the customer, because in that way, if there's a, you know, any major liability, the exposure is limited, one, to the extent of the equity of the parent in the sub, and second, the guarantee support provided by the parent. So it's more from the commercial side. But yes, you know, if there's a much bigger contract which is spanning over many countries, then yes, possibly a customer will have a performance guarantee contract where we'll have a parent also, we will also have a sub together. So it's more of because of commercial reasons why we have a performance contract between a sub and the customer in that particular country, and not directly with guarantor.
And another question, John, this one is to you. Can you elaborate on why using an option pricing model is not an appropriate methodology?
Yes, I sort of touched on that. It's the option pricing model is specifically built to estimate what a guarantee fee would be for a loan obligation. So it's not specific to a performance guarantee. A performance guarantee, as I mentioned, is treated quite differently than a financial guarantee in terms of risk weighting and therefore pricing by financial institutions. So the option pricing model isn't built for that. It's built to determine, as I mentioned, it's really trying to determine what that contingent claim that the guarantor would have on the assets of the borrower translates into a guarantee fee. And without getting into the specifics of the Black-Scholes model, there's a lot of inputs into that that are at best sometimes estimated, and specifically, again, it just isn't built for that. So I've used that model many, many times in the past. I don't use it very often anymore for loan-related guarantees. It is very difficult to defend in front of a tax authority because of the inputs and because it's just a black box. So I would say it's not relevant to performance guarantees, and it's difficult to use for loan guarantees.
All right, John, thank you very much. And with that, we conclude today's presentation. We would like to thank our presenters today, Virendra Sharma and John Hollis. Once again, the presentation today will be available on the TPA website within the next 48 hours, so any of the attendees that would like to have a copy of today's presentation will be able to do so by visiting the TPA website and downloading the presentation. And we hope to see all of you back here again in the future at future TPA WebEx presentations. And there are a few questions that are still coming in, and those will be addressed by Virendra and John via email a little bit later on. Once again, have a good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever the case may be, wherever in the world you are. This is Transfer Pricing Associates in Amsterdam. Good day.